Okay, Jasmine is having problems apparently. Okay. But anyway, the meeting is going to be recorded. So the people who are not in here, I know we have more than this for this class. So the people who are not in here, they should be able to get the recording and later on basically go through the steps and make sure that they have this lab and then mastered. I don't honestly expect to expect to see it more. I mean, the problem is the fact that we're not doing hands-on, and that's a problem. And we're going to rely on some pictures, basically, and some links on websites, as I'm going to give you right now, and basically answer the questions to the best of your abilities. That's all we can do at this point. Okay. I want to make sure that everybody I know in here, we don't have like last time in here. Okay, Kelsey is here with us too, because she was worried earlier about getting able to get on or not and things like that. So we still have a little bit of people to come in, but we have more than half. That's good enough for this session. Anyway, let me share with you something in here on the screen to get started with it first. And I'm going to share with you all of this stuff on Canvas, and I'm going to actually give you a few links in here. This is basically where we left off last time. I went online and downloaded this pictures. These are free pictures. They are not copyrighted there is no violation of any rules or whatever. When I looked for these pictures, I made sure that they are not protected by anything. These are free pictures. And if we did the lab, actually the picture would look like this one. The iron filings, they're very, very small pieces of iron, basically. And then when you spread them, they follow the lines because they want to go from basically north to south. The convention is red is north and south is white. And in here, the field lines, as you can clearly see, they're following this. This is how the picture would have looked. And if you had a camera with you and if we actually did a lab, this is how the pictures would look. Unfortunately, I couldn't find the horseshoe or two different that are free. There are pictures out there for them with the iron filings, but they're not free, basically. I cannot show them, at least at this point. Probably privately, maybe we can look at them or something. Anyway, I have a couple of links that I'm going to share with you guys, too. I'm going to put them on the chat session, basically, so that you can grab them right now first. So this is for the magnetic field. Both of them are from WikiLeaks. So Wikipedia, I'm sorry. Okay, so I don't want to have that. So everyone in the meeting. Okay, so this is one. So that's for the magnetic field. Let me share with you the second link is for the electric field. So if you are using a computer, you can go on either one of these sites because I'm going to go quickly on them to give you a feel of basically what the verbiage is and what the words to use and how the things look like and everything else trying to answer the lab. When you're doing magnetism, the key thing you have to do is your right hand. I know probably the screen is displaying what looks to you like it's my left hand, and that's because of the laws of reflection and optics. When you stand in front of the mirror, the right and left gets reversed. So basically, this is one of the things that happen. So you have to use your right hand, basically, okay, for the magnetic field. Every time you're asked a question, and there are a few questions in here that involve the right hand, basically, you have a charge in one direction, magnetic field is another direction, in which direction the force will be will be experienced as far as the charge is, it's going to be in the middle finger, basically. So you have the thumb, you have the, is this the index? You have the index for the magnetic field, and the thumb is for the direction of the charge, where it's moving, the velocity, basically. The index is the direction of the magnetic field, and the thumb is going to be, I mean, the middle finger is going to be the direction where your force is going to be. Have you guys seen rap musicians? Yes? No? Nobody? That's what they do, actually. They do the magnetic field, all of them. I mean, they talk so fast. you slow them down, they're talking about magnetic fields and charges and things like that. Yeah. I don't know. Probably try it, okay? Okay, anyway, so that's one of the things that we need for our experiments in here. So you really need your right hand rule in here. I see a lot of people now joining in. So most of the class is in session right now. Most of everybody is in here. That's good. What else in here? So let's take into those question at a time. But before I do that, I'd like to share with you those links. The websites again. So let's start with the magnetic field, because the lab starts with the magnetic field. So I'm going to pull a website in here and go to the magnetic field, to the Wikipedia link for the magnetic field. And let me start the sharing for that. Andrea Carriere is having a problem, probably. Okay. So I'm going to share that link again. Okay, so this is the website, basically, when you go to it for the magnetic field. It has everything that you, and it has in here a horseshoe-looking magnet. This is a permanent magnet. And the magnetic field lines, again, they leave the North Pole and go to the South Pole. Everywhere in here, including the entire area. So this is one of the questions that you probably have in there. Different stuff in here is going for the magnetic field. Again, B is the magnetic field. Don't worry about H&M. H&M have something else to do with the magnetic field. We are not interested in them. If you're going to be reading in here, the only thing that you should focus on is the B field. That's what we're dealing with. And you don't really need to know a lot of the math behind it. All you need to know is basically the fact that if you have a charge moving in a region and somehow is deflected, then you know that it's in the presence of a magnetic field, basically. That's really a poor way of defining the magnetic field, to be honest with you, because it could be also in the presence of an electric field that does that too. But there is a better way, actually, a compass with a needle on it. So whichever way the compass goes, that's basically where the magnetic field is. So that's one way of discovering the magnetic field, with a compass and the needle, the one that Boy Scouts have all the time with them to try to find their way in the desert and somewhere else. Okay? I mean, at night, especially at night, and trying to navigate your way. I mean, you don't have to be, even in navigation in the old days, basically when you are in the oceans, you use compasses. That's what they were invented for, actually, initially. Okay, the electric field in here, I'm going to go to the same website in here and find similar discussions. The electric field turned out to be slightly easier than the magnetic field, because for the magnet, you have to have a north pole and a south pole always together. I have some magnets in here I was playing with earlier. I don't know if you see them in here. So if I turn this one around, it's going to attach itself. So this is basically now south and north and south. And if I split them, I have two magnets in here. But if I put them in the opposite direction again, north and south spaces. But if I try to push them against one another, they are not going to go. This is something that we played with ever since we were young. And this is no different. There is no magic about it. And we'll try to understand it. Why is that? Oh man, Ethan also is having problems. Anyway, I have other magnets in here, actually. And this is a little bit bigger magnet than anything else. Magnets, they are basically three elements. They attract one another so much. iron, nickel, and what is that? I forgot the third one. I think it's not cobalt. I forgot. Anyway, the iron basically stands for ferromagnets. That's the main material that does the permanent magnet. Magnetic properties, and this is something that, did you guys do this in class already? Let me check the chat session here to see if, did you do magnetism already in class in lecture? Yes or no? Melissa said yes, I don't know. Yeah, good. Very good. Okay, very good. So you guys going through magnetism, and magnetism is one of the things that are that has basically, it was discovered, it was not understood until toward the end of actually the 19th century, around 1887, when Maxwell published his equations, that's really when magnetism was tied to the electric field. And actually, there are two things. This electric field and magnetic field, they go one on one. Okay, for magnet, you need north and south. You need two different kinds of magnetic charges. You're going to call them magnetic charges. And the electric field, on the other hand, you need the positive charge and the negative charge, okay? And again, the fact that they're called positive and negative is just by convention. And the fact that they are called north and south, they were initially called that because of the fact that the needle is pointing toward the north. So they figured that magnets, they also behave like Earth, which has a north and a south. And that's basically how they came up with this convention. You cannot separate the magnet bar from north and south. They come always in pairs. For the charges, you can isolate the positive charge and a negative charge. That's the biggest difference between the two. Okay, monopoles in the case of charges exist, and that's why you could have an electric field leaving a positive charge and going everywhere in space and never come back, basically. For a negative charge, you can have it sitting by itself, and it's basically sucking on all of the field lines for the electric field from everywhere into it. And they go there, and they don't come out at all. Like a sink, basically. A sink, water flows in it. And as far as you're concerned, you don't know where it's going, and you don't care. All the flow is going, and it's going, period. It's not coming back out. The faucet, on the other hand, is like the positive charge. The water is coming from it permanently, so when you have it on. So that's basically the image you can do for the electric field. In terms of the magnetic field, though, the sink and the source, which is the faucet, they come in pairs. They always do one next to one another. You cannot separate them. So if there is a flow, ultimately it's going to come back to the sink. So that's basically the image that you can have between the two of them. As a matter of fact, a lot of the mass is borrowed from hydrodynamics, the flow of fluids, basically, fluid dynamics. And that's how these things are working. Again, the electric field, the field lines. So let's go to our lab. Any questions in general? I hope that you guys are doing this with your class and you have an understanding of that. How do I discover an electric field? I need a 1 coulomb charge with me. If you have a 1 coulomb charge, basically what you can do to it, I have some goodies in here. If you have a 1 coulomb charge, you attach the 1 coulomb charge to a mass spring. This measures the force, actually, and you attach it. And if the charge doesn't move, that means this charge is not under any kind of, it's not inside an electric field, at least. But if this charge starts to move one way or the other, compress or elongate the spring, that means that there is a magnetic electric field, and that electric field, you know its direction based on which way this spring is this stretching or compressing. So you know its magnitude and you know its direction. And the magnitude is exactly the force exerted on a 1 coulomb. However, practically you can do that. That's part of the lab that we have in session in here, that you cannot carry a 1 coulomb with you. There is a different technique that you have to employ to find the electric field, the direction and the magnitude. It's very easy to visualize the electric field, the magnetic field, with the iron filing as of pictures, which I'm going to share with you. But for the electric field, you need some work to find it, okay? So any questions so far in general? No? Okay. So let's get into the lab now. Let me get the file going first. There are two files that we need for the lab. Two PDF files, they're in here. So let me stop sharing those links in there. And let me share the PDF files. The PDF file, the one that I want to share is, first of all, let's get the instructions. Remember, a lot of these instructions are actually not just directly for you guys for Physics 100, so they're actually for a lot of classes, including Physics 110, including Physics 251, actually, which is the calc-based course. So they're all sharing the same information. So basically, it's a good idea to read and ignore the math in here. the math is simple, straightforward, actually. For the gravitational force, the force of the gravity, is, which is the weight, actually is proportional to the field, which is the G, which is 9.8 meters per second squared. For the case of the electric field and the charge, it's proportional to it. This is the electrostatic electric field. That's a key word, because there is a question toward the end that you need to answer. And the electrostatic field and the force, the electric force in this case, are always parallel to one another. If the charge is positive, they're in the same direction. If the charge is negative, they're opposite to one another. Because if Q is negative, let's say, for example, it's negative 10 times E, which is this way. So you take E, you scale it by a factor of 10, and you flip it around. If Q is positive, then all you have to do is scale it up. The question at the end, is it always parallel? Yes, in the case of electrostatic, because there is sometimes, I mean, in the case of when it's not, when there is time-dependent phenomenon, this thing becomes a little bit involved. It's not as simple as that. Anyway, and for the charge moving inside an magnetic field, it's going to experience this, basically, rotation. It goes like in a cyclotron, basically, and you can find the frequency for that. So basically, it's going to go on a circle. Okay, like a helix. Helix if it has a component in one direction, otherwise it's going to go in like a circle. Because the velocity, this is from a chapter you did on Newton's laws, the velocity vector and the force are perpendicular all the time. So in this case, the force changes motion, but doesn't change the magnitude of the velocity, it changes the direction of the velocity. So the particle will actually go in a circle, and you can find the radius of that circle. This is what started actually the nuclear accelerators, this principle, using this idea, and in the so-called cyclotron accelerator, and they use this one, basically they use the magnetic field to force the protons to move back into a region where there is an electric field, and the electric field accelerates the particle, and the particle is forced to come back to the electric field, and each time it comes back, they flip the polarity of the electric field, so that it's always gaining speed until it comes out at incredible speed. That is the principle of the cyclotron, basically, and it's based on a combination of this law and that law. So this is one of the applications. I know that you're probably, this is an introductory course, but I want you to have a feel of this thing also, because you're doing it, you're supposed to do it at least hands-on, but this has a lot of applications in engineering and physics and everywhere else. So, and there's a lot of applications. So if you go to the hospital and you do some sort of an imaging on you, they use a lot of this technique and you're involving the magnetic field and things like that. Anyway, this is basically a dipole. This is actually a quadrupole in this case. You have four charges. Two are negative and two are positive. And I don't know the convention here, honestly, but it doesn't matter. If the red ones are negative, so in this case, basically, all the electric fields are coming in there, but there are two of them in here, and there are two positives in here, so the electric fields leave the blue ones and come and die in the red ones. Okay, if it's the other way around, they leave the inner region and they go to the outer region. So there are four charges in here of equal magnitude, that's what the quadrupole means. Dipole, you have two. Okay, so the magnetic field. This is the lab that if we were going to do it, you put a bar magnet, and then you put the surface in here so that basically the iron, so that the paper doesn't sink completely, because you're going to put a white paper, and then you sprinkle the iron filings on it, and you see those images form, because the iron filings will try to follow the field lines. And again, you're supposed to draw it, and I gave you already the drawing for at least some of the geometries, and you can use those as a basis for your lab. Okay, question one, what is the magnetic field? What produces a magnetic field, and what is in said field in order to produce a magnetic force? So this is question one. So first of all, the purpose of the first activity is actually to study the magnetic field, mainly its direction. The direction of the magnetic field. That's basically what we're trying to understand. We don't measure in this lab the strength of the magnetic field. Okay. But what we do measure in this case is the direction of the magnetic field. So the question is, what is a magnetic field? Magnetic field is how basically a region of space is modified, and you can read, probably you can put it in your own words, is modified in the presence by some sources of magnetic field. In this case, usually it's current. And that's the next question in here. Magnetic field, it's current. So currents modify their surrounding by creating this field, which it can always detect using a compass. Okay. What must be placed in said magnetic field to see the force? You have to have a charge moving in there. If you have a charge moving in there, it's going to experience and the magnetic field, and that's basically what you need. Usually, you give a charge velocity V, and there is something called the velocity selector, so you know exactly its velocity, how much it is, and the direction of it, and how much the charge it is. So you know all of these things, and if this charge deflects in one way or the other, then you know that there is a magnetic field in there. So that's basically experimentally how you can find even the strength of the magnetic field, because once you measure that force, you can find what the magnitude of B is. However, with a compass, you can always find the magnetic field. So what produces it? It's the electric field. What does it, I'm sorry, not the electric, the electric current is the one that produces it. So a current must produce the magnetic field. And that's Ampere's law, actually, that states that. And what is it? It's a change to the region surrounding that current. And what must be placed in the electric field to produce a force? Then a charge moving in it will be deflected, and you will see basically from there, based on that, that there is a magnetic field in there. Okay? Any questions about this question? I see more people joining in now. So I think I have only about two or three people who are not in here. Any questions so far? Let me make sure we don't have any funny audience in here too. Okay, let me stop the sharing quickly, okay? Okay, Andrea is good. So she sent me a message earlier. And so is Ethan also. So everybody now is familiar. Okay, please use your full names, okay? So that we don't have any problems in there later, especially in terms of the attendance. Let me check quickly the attendance in here. Okay. Okay. Let me go back into sharing the screen then. Okay. So the first question, we got it. Since it's recorded, guys, you can come back later on and look at it. And if there is a question and it's not clear, please do ask it in the forum so that anybody can answer it first of all. And if I'm not around, and if I'm around, I'll be more than happy to discuss it. And if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. I don't know everything in here. Although, if there is anything I should know, it's magnetism, okay? Yeah. My thesis was on it, so I should know. So if a magnetic field is produced by an ensemble of uniformly moving electric charges, where are these uniformly moving electric charges in a permanent magnet? Where is the question? That's a good question, okay? This is a permanent magnet. Okay, let me see, where is my camera? Here is the camera. This is a permanent magnet, okay? I'm holding it in my hand. And I just said in the previous question that it's produced, I mean, the magnetic field, it has magnetism in here. I don't have a needle with me in here. I mean, compass, but you will see that the compass will actually move around in here with this electric, with the magnetic field. So where is the current in this case? So that's the question. Two people trying right here. Okay. Okay, very good. Okay, so Martin thinks that the magnetic field comes from the motion of the electrons inside the material, also known as the electron spin. They are all in one direction. That's very good. That's actually the explanation that you have. The only trouble with that is normally a magnet like this one, and this I did it when I was actually in middle school. I had a magnet and it was a very cold night, just like in here. Actually, it was a lot colder than this one, and we had a fire at home. So, and I had magnet and I was playing with it and I put it on the spoon actually, and I put it on the fire. And then I tried to put it back on the metal and it was not attracting anything. Okay, it was not attracting anything. So I was devastated. First of all, I lost my magnet. It was not working anymore. And then I went and I asked my science teacher, and he told me about the Curie temperature, which I never heard of at that point. And it's a permanent magnet. Every permanent magnet has a point where if it reaches it, in terms of temperature, it's going to lose its magnetism and become demagnetized, actually. This is what happened earlier today when I was playing with this magnet. This is one part of the set that I had shown you earlier. I did not raise its temperature. As a matter of fact, I put it next to this magnet, and this magnet was a very strong magnet. So basically, it destroyed its orientations in here, and it made it basically useless. Because this is a very powerful magnet versus this one, and the magnetism is now completely random. So Martin and everybody else, here is the trouble. This is iron, actually. And I don't have another piece of iron in here. Actually, this is actually iron too. No, this is not iron. But basically what I'm trying to say is the following. You can have two pieces of iron. One is magnetized, one is a magnet, and one is not. So why is that? Why is there one of them is a magnet and the other one is not? You just said that it's the motion of the electrons inside the material, also known. Okay, the spin is not really the, let me stop the sharing of the screen. Let me go into the other screen in here. Let me share with you this screen in here. Trying to understand this one in here. So I'm going to draw an atom, basically. Okay, this is the nucleus of the atom. There's a bunch of stuff, neutrons and protons, which we don't care for. Most of the time, the charges, they're well hidden inside that they don't do anything. And they have a bunch of layers in here for electrons. And usually you have the outer layer that has one or two or three or sometimes more electrons in it. In the case of some atoms like the iron, they have an odd number of electrons. If they have an odd number of electrons, an electron or all particles, basically they have a property called the spin. Just like they have a mass, they have a charge, they have a spin. And spin, you can think of it just like Martin has said, basically as if the electron moves around itself, basically going in a rotation around its own axis, which is a very not accurate picture at all, because it's not a classical particle. And this is just a simplistic, basically, image to think about it. So when it's spinning, as if it's creating a current, and that current is basically what you call a spin. So that's one way. And the other thing is, this electron is moving around the atom somehow. But some electrons, this electron is not moving in one direction. Actually, it's moving in a lot of directions. And this effect should cancel, basically, at the end, especially given the fact that you have so many atoms in the atom. And if this electron is moving this way, this electron could be moving in the opposite direction altogether. And they do cancel on average. And that's what makes iron. So why, again, if you guys know, do we have permanent magnets that is made out of iron, like this one? I mean, the answer is there. Any idea? Okay, Micah thinks they are all in one direction, the current aligns them. Okay, this current in here I don't feel it. Do you see that? Okay, very good. So Brandon has the correct answer. You guys did this, didn't you? So it's the domains, okay? The magnetic domains. Let me give you a brief, basically, answer to this one quickly here. Okay, so man. And then we will move on, because this question is, we're trying to answer it for part of our lab. Some materials like iron, you have a bunch of atoms next to one another, and each one of them, I'm just drawing the outer electrons, and the outer electrons now, basically, like you guys said, this electron is moving in this direction, this electron is moving in this direction, this electron is moving in this direction, and they cancel. So basically, the net effect is there is a region of space, not just on the atomic level, on the macroscopic level, basically, where the electrons appears to be making current. That's number one. Number two now, regions that are next to one another. So now when we zoom out of the material, so I will see that the material itself, the magnet, is divided into different regions called domains. And this domain is basically, if the region of magnetization is pointing this way, this one is pointing that way, this one is this way, this one is this way, there is a net after I magnetize it for some reason or the other, after it gains magnetism, that the regions are leaning on one another. Basically, they are helping one another to stand up in one direction or the other, and they retain their magnetism after you remove the what gave them magnetism. So it's right. I mean, Brandon has it correct. It's the alignment of the domains next to one another in what is called the self-consistent solution. And so basically, they lean on one another. But on the atomic level, it should be completely random. Most of the materials are random anyway, and they don't have magnetism. Few elements, they help one another, basically, and they stay. They retain their magnetism after the what caused it to exist. So let me stop the screen, and let me go back into the lab. Share. The lab. So basically, if a magnetic is produced, so the answer to it, yes, there is currents that are due to the motion of the electrons inside the atom. And once they're taken on average together, they form basically currents in different regions called domains. They help one another basically to retain their magnetism. So those are permanent magnets. And like the electromagnets, an electromagnet is made temporarily with a current. So this is an electromagnet, actually. In the case of an electromagnet, you have a current that comes from this end and goes from the other end and goes several times through a normal conducting material like copper, like this one in here. And if there is a battery in here, I can connect to the battery and you will see the needle actually moving. So this is an electromagnet. Once you cut the current, there is no more magnet. The other one stays in. Okay, so that's basically the answer to that. Now, question three, it turns out that the direction of the magnetic field FB is perpendicular to the magnetic field B and the velocity V. So the question in here is, which way the force is pointing? Okay. Somebody answer toward us. How did you find it? Basically, it has to be perpendicular toward the, since the plane of the paper or the plane of the screen is where the where the magnetic field is. And where the particle is coming down is raining to downstairs. So in this case, the force can be either into or out of the screen, basically. Into or out of the screen, because it has to be both perpendicular to B and perpendicular to Q. And is this charge? Since the charge, the sign of the charge was not stated, it turns out the direction of the vector is perpendicular to, is always proportional to the velocity vn. For the illustration, what direction would it be? Now, it matters the sign, the charge, the sign of the charge. If Q is positive, this is the direction of the velocity. You start always with the velocity v, and this is the direction of the magnetic field. So it's coming towards me. It's coming out of the screen if the charge is positive. You guys understand the answer to it? Using the right-hand rule, again, the velocity is going down, the magnetic field is going to the other side, and then the force will be pointing in here. So if I put a charge moving this way, I will feel it bending this way, coming towards me, if it's, the charge is positive. If the charge is negative, it's going to go into the screen. So that's basically how this, the answer to this question is. Yes? So the key in here is the right-hand rule, basically. And B is your thumb. The index is the magnetic field B, and the velocity is the middle finger, basically. That gives you the overall the direction of the force. This is good. Okay. Now, what can be said about the work done by a magnetic field on a moving electric charge? Did you guys do this in class or not, about the work of the magnetostatic force? Okay, so the magnetic field does not do work. Again, all it does is basically, it does not give an extra velocity, because in order to do work, you have to give more kinetic energy, or if it's a friction, for example, it's a force that is taking work, taking energy from the system, draining energy from the system, then in that case, it's going to be again, the velocity will go down. So you gain kinetic energy or you lose kinetic energy. But this force does not do neither. The velocity, the speed stays the same. Since the speed stays the same, the only thing that changes is direction of the velocity. Then there is no gain in speed, no loss in speed. So this force does not do work or does not drain energy from the system. It's not like friction. So in this case, the magnetic field does no work, okay? And it's because, very easy to see, the displacement, which is the velocity, and the force are perpendicular. And in this case, when the force is perpendicular to the displacement, there is no work, okay? So that's the reason why there is no work in here. So all it does, basically, is just make the particle go in circles, okay? And when you go in circles, you don't do work. You don't gain velocity or lose velocity. You don't gain speed, that is, or lose speed, because the kinetic energy has to do with the speed, because you square the velocity. Once you square the velocity, it doesn't matter the direction anymore, okay? So that ends the questions on the magnetic field. Are the questions on the electric field? The questions on the electric field are a little bit easier in terms, because first of all, you don't have the right-hand rule. It's much easier than that one. Coulomb's force basically gives you how much the strength of the force that is exerted between two charges, Q and Q, one capital Q, one small Q. It's inversely proportional to R, and it's always in the direction between the two charges. Just like when you did gravity, basically. Similar to gravity. The only difference with the gravity is gravity is always attractive force. This one can be a repulsive force. Two charges of the same sign repel each other, whether positive versus positive or negative versus negative. But two charges of different signs, they will always attract one another, This is exactly what happened in gravity. Okay? Now the potential, and that is, there is a question down the road coming in there, the potential is always a number. So when you go to your house, and you are in your house now, so when you plug in your phone, for example, to charge, you're plugging your device to the actual voltage, which is 120 volts, and the wall. So that is V, and actually it's not a voltage, it's the difference in voltage. What matters is not the potential at some point. What matters is the difference of potential in one point versus another point. Just like the height. What matters is not the height, the elevation where you're moving, but how much you gain height or how much you lose height. This is exactly similar with the electric potential. The electric field can be sensed, again, I already said that, using one Coulomb charge. If you cannot afford one Coulomb charge, you can use a micro Coulomb charge if you like, connect it to a spring to measure the force. And if that force basically comes out to be a number, all you have to do is just basically multiply it by the charge. Because one Coulomb will give you this much force, a smaller charge will give you that much force. So basically you have to scale it up in this case to get the correct value. Okay? But practically it's not practical because you cannot carry with you charges, whether even one microcoulomb, charges get neutralized, so you can't do that. So there is a different technique, and the technique involves the potential actually. You can show this dipole in here. What I have in here, I have a positive Q and I have a negative Q. Okay, so the red is negative and the blue is positive. So the dashed lines in here that you see are regions where the potential is the same. It does not change. So let's take an example. This is what we would have done in the lab. We take those pins, we put them on the paper, conducting paper basically, and then you run wires coming from the power source, and one of them will be will have a positive charge and one of them will have a negative charge. So in this case, you create an electric field in that region between those two pins. So what you do in this case, you take the voltmeter that measures the volts for you, how much volts do you have in here, and you connect the negative end of it to one side, to the negative side, and the positive, and the positive you start finding, chasing basically after the electric field. If you come anywhere in here, let's say for example you have 12 volts source, so in this case the difference in potential is 12 volts. So if this one was 0 volts, this one would be 12 volts. If this point is 175 volts, this one is 175 plus 12, which is 187 volts. So what matters, like I said, is not the volt in one point and the other one, because the power source is giving me 12 volts. So in this case, the difference between them is 12 volts. So if I measure the electric potential in point near it, it's going to be very close from 12 volts. It's going to be probably 11.7 volts immediately, or 11.8 volts. So what I do in this case, I follow the dashed line and I measure the 11.8 volts all the way through. This region is the same voltage called the equipotential. So the equipotential is what I'm actually plotting on that paper. Okay, so that's what I do. Then I move to another region. Let's say, for example, I find an 11.5 volts. I'm going to find the 11.5 volts, and again, I trace the 11.5 volts. I move on until, let's say, for example, I find the 10 volts in here, and I trace the 10 volts in here. I move on, let's say, for example, this would be the 7 volts in here, so I go into the 7 volts. This would be the 6, no, this would be, for example, the 7.5 volts or 6.5 volts. This would be somewhere in between. This would be around 6 volts, okay, somewhere midway. The midway will be actually a line that does not bend toward this side. It's going to be a line that's going to extend as far as I can go, okay? And then I start now following the smaller voltage, let's say the 5 volts, okay? The dashed lines, basically, the question is about this thing in here. Do you guys see this thing in here? So as long as I'm following the dashed line in here, let's say, for example, this is the 5 volts, this is the 4 volts, and this is, and I'm following until I find very close from the, let's say this is the 1 volt in here, and this is the 0.5 volt, this 0.23 volts, and so on and so forth. The point being in here is I am following the lines where the potential is the same. And I can read this on the multimeter itself. I can see, if I put it in here, for example, and this is, let's say, for example, is a 7 volt. If I move it in here, I find 6.8. Now I move it back, I find 7 volts. I move it in here, for example, find 6.9, for example. I move it closer, I find the 7 volts. I move it in here, I find 7.3 volts. I move it back, I find the 7 volts. So basically what I'm trying to do in here is zero in on this 7 volts until I find completely all of them together. And now I have the drawing for this 7 volt equipotential, basically. I have to chase it with the device, with the measurements in here. That's what would have been done. That's what would be the biggest thing in that. Once we find these regions, these are the equipotentials. These are the regions where the voltage is the same. That's what the equipotential is. So voltage, same voltage. Okay. Remember, what I am actually measuring this voltage is in reference to another point. And usually the reference point is this one. So the 7 volts is from here. So there is a drop in potential from 12 volts all the way down to 0 volts in here. Okay, so that's basically what this thing region is saying in here. This drop corresponds to the region of the electric field. So the electric field goes pulse with which way the potential is dropping. Since the potential is higher in this region, so this is the vector for the electric field. The electric field is a vector, it's not a number. The potential is a scalar. That's what I can measure in the lab. I cannot measure this vector directly. So what I do in this case is I follow, I take a point, doesn't matter which point in here, and I follow the perpendicular to this equipotential region. So this is a normal, this is perpendicular, until I find back into this one in here. And this will be one single field line. I find the perpendicular again, just doesn't matter which direction I start, until I find it back, coming back into in here. And so on and so forth, and continue drawing them. The one in between is going to shoot straight from the positive charge to the negative charge, because it's gonna be perpendicular to all of the equipotentials. And this point, which is the middle point, is gonna be always perpendicular this way. So the electric field will be pointing this way. The electric field will be pointing in the same direction in here. The electric field will be pointing in here and will be pointing in here. One key thing in here, the denser the electric field lines, the stronger the electric field. So near the charges, there are more field lines, and in here too, so that means the electric field is very strong near the charges. Away from the charges, as you can see in here, there is a lot of space between these field lines, so that means the electric field is weaker there. So if I bring a charge in here, 1 coulomb, and put it in here, for example, it's gonna feel weak electric field. In other words, the spring doesn't move much, the force I measure is very weak. But if I bring it closer in here, and if it's a positive charge, it's going to be pulled toward this negative charge. It's going to be very strong electric field in here. If I put it near this one, it's going to be repelled very strongly. If I put it in here, it's going to be repelled, but not as strongly. The closer the field lines, the denser the field lines, the stronger the electric field. The denser they are, the stronger. The widespread they are, the less dense they are, the weaker the electric field. So that's basically how we measure this one in the lab. Okay? Questions? You have an understanding of how this thing works, at least conceptually? Yes or no? Okay, very good. So now basically, it goes into the multimeter is the one that you use basically to find the voltage. And you have the probe, you have the power source. This is what I was talking about, except in the lab, I mean, unfortunately we cannot do it. You will have pins, which is here, they are in this picture in here, which you're going to put them. Once you put them on the paper, the conducting paper, you put them properly in here, press them against that. And then there is actually a product underneath your douche to make sure that the material basically is conducting your receiving charges. And now you start measuring. Several configurations you do, you put a point in here and you connect them to the power supply. you put a whole line in here and a whole line in here, and this simulates capacitors. Did you guys do capacitor in class or not yet? Okay, so this would simulate the capacitor. This would simulate more or less that configuration that we have earlier for the quadrupole. But the quadrupole in this case, I only have two sources. I have only a positive and negative. So what I do in this case, I connect these two points and they become the same charge versus this one, which is in the middle and negative, the positive charge if this are negative or vice versa. And then I start measuring the field lines and redraw that picture that I have that we started with. Not this one for the dipole, the one with the quadrupole that we started all the way to the top in here somewhere. Yeah. Okay. So that's going to produce that picture for us for the electric field. And this one is a charge near a basically a line. So that's basically what we would have done. Unfortunately, we can't do it. So we're going to continue answering the questions for the rest of the lab. And the visualization is basically based on if you can get a GeoGebra going for you, that's actually good too, because that gives you a visualization of how the electric field works for the charges. Now, question 5, what is an electric field? Again, a charge. So what produces, I can answer the second part, what produces an electric field is a charge. Charge is the one that creates an electric expression in here for the electric field. The charge Q, Ke is just a number, it's like 12. It's actually a number that is 9 times 10 to the power 9 in SI. But it's just a constant, really. Distance is how far we are from the charge, and this is the electric field. So what makes an electric field is Q. If I don't have Q, I don't have an electric field. Basically the part of the answer to this question. What creates an electric field is a charge. What is the question? Yeah. What produces the electric field is charge. So what is the electric field itself? Is a charge modifying its surrounding in such a way that it's going to basically, if I bring a test charge, it's going to feel it. What must be placed in said far to produce an electric force, another charge. So you bring another charge and put it next to this charge, now you will see the force. Of course, this charge has to be nailed, otherwise it's gonna move too. So the charge that produces the electric field has to be nailed, like just like this one in here. It has to be nailed actually in place. It has to be put in place, okay? This is electrostatic. When we're not doing electrostatic, it's a different story. Electrostatic, the sources of the electric field are fixed in place. The sources of the magnetic field are steady current. Current doesn't change. If you have 10 amps running through the wire, 10 amps run through the wire. It's not going to go to 11 amps or 12 amps or come down. If it changes over time, that means it's not a magnetostatic anymore. It's something else. Same thing with the electrostatics in here. So what creates the magnetic field, the electric field is a charge that is fixed in space. And it's going to modify its space. Now, if I bring a test charge, that test charge is going to feel the presence of that electric field. So how do I know what must be brought into it for the said electric field? It's a charge. You bring another charge in, it's going to feel it. Okay? And it's going to feel it based on this expression. This one. The middle one. So this is now the charge that you bring in, Q, is going to feel the electric field that is produced by the Q in here. And that's the force that you can measure in the lab. Okay, so we answered this question. Question 5. Question 6. What is an electric potential? What produces an electric potential? And what must be placed in a said electric potential to produce an electric potential energy? So the relationship between the potential and the electric potential and the, first of all, what creates an electric potential is the same thing, is a charge. But that modification, not in a vector point, it's basically changing its surrounding by creating basically different regions of different voltages. Now, that's basically what that is. If you bring another charge in here, that charge will have energy in it. So let's say, for example, you have a positive charge in here, nailed, it's fixed, it's not moving. and you try to bring another positive charge in here, you're going to fight the electrostatic force to do that. So you're building energy. You need energy to do that. So if you put this one now and you fix it in space, there is an energy in here waiting to be released. If I let go of this charge, it's going to fly away. You guys understand? So there is a potential energy just by bringing another positive charge next to a positive charge. Now, if there is a positive charge in here sitting still, and there is a negative charge, you put it in here. If you keep it in there, you need energy to keep it in there. If you let go of it, it's going to go and move towards the positive charge. Again, that is potential energy. The charge will always pull, move, I mean, the positive charge will always move from the higher potential energy toward the lower potential energy. In other words, positive charge will go from higher voltage down to lower voltage. Just like a mass, when you take a mass and you drop it, it's going to drop from high to low. So this is what we experience day in, day out. However, if the charge is negative, it's going to fall from low to high. So basically, this is an uncommon thing that we don't see it in day in, day out. If I have an object, it doesn't matter what that object is. And to grab an object in here so that I don't do a lot of damage, let me grab my glasses in here. If I let go of the glasses, they will fall. They fall due to gravity. That's exactly what a positive charge also would do inside an electric field. It's going to fall from higher potential toward lower potential. But a negative charge will fall backward. We don't have negative masses. If we have negative masses, they will all be in the ceiling. So we have to grab them. We have to actually nail them on the floor before they all fly up. That's basically why we don't experience this phenomenon with masses. Masses always fall down, just like positive charges. But negative charges behave differently in that they fall to the ceiling. And negative masses would do that, but we don't have them. Okay. So again, that's how we can we experience that. What is the question again? What be said in there to find potential energy? Well, you need to bring another charge. If that charge is positive, it's going to fall from high to low in terms of voltage. So if you have 120 volts, that charge is going to fall from high to low. But if the charge is negative, it's going to fall from 0 to 120 volts. It's going to fall backward, actually. Unfortunately, that's exactly what's going on with the electrical current. The charges, when you plug in your device to charge, for example, is actually everything is falling from low to high because the charges are actually negative, the ones that are falling. These are the electrons. So basically what you have a battery source in here, and the battery source has a positive pole and a negative pole, and the current is flowing from positive to negative, but actually what is doing the motion is electrons are going from negative to positive. Okay, so that answered question 6. Hopefully you guys have an understanding of it. If not, review this recording later on or ask me a question, or please let me know how we can do it better, okay? Question 7. Is question 6 good? Yes? Okay, good. So, question 7. How are the electric and electric field and electric potential, how are they alike and how are they different? For one thing, one of them is a number. One of them is a scalar. And the other is a vector. The electric potential is a number. It's 120 volts. You never hear them 120 volts moving south or going north. There is no direction for the electric potential. And the electric field, though, is a vector. It's pointing from the positive charge toward the negative charge. So that's one difference. One of them is related to the force. The electric field is related to the force. And because the force is a vector, the electric field is a vector. The other one is related to the energy, potential energy, to be more specific. The electric potential is a number related to the electrical potential, electrical energy, basically. Both of them are, they play a different role. Now, there is a big relationship between them. In electrostatics, the E field derives from the electrical potential. That is a big word that is used in there, and that means that the electrostatic force is a conservative force. It's not like, for example, friction. It's it doesn't depend on the path, and that is critical. That's how we get energy from electrical, basically electrostatics. That's why we have batteries. Okay, batteries, they create for us electrostatic fields, and because they have a difference of potential, and the process they make it with it is non-conservative. They actually have a chemical process going inside the battery or some other process, for example, or you have maybe somebody doing something like turning something in there and moving the charges, and that is not an electrostatic process. That is not a conservative process. But the outcome in here is energy that we can use to move charges and do work with it. That's why it's so important for us day in, day out. It's really the backbone of our modern civilization is electricity and magnetism. Okay? That's really what made everything possible for us. Without it, we would not be able to communicate through this medium. Okay? So these are some of the differences and some of the similarities. They are basically, they're created by electrical charges, and that's the biggest thing is they're interconnected through the last point I made in here, the fact that an electric potential is the source of the electric field in a sense, okay? The electric field derives from it, it comes from it, okay? It comes from the electric potential. It's not the cause. The cause, both of them is made by charge. Charge is the electrostatic charge, is charge that doesn't move, is one that creates them. It is said that the direction of the electric force is always in the direction of, what is it? As that of the electric field. Under what circumstances is the previous statement not true? This statement is true in electrostatic cases all the time. There are cases which is not true, but we shouldn't get into them. And the key relationship is this one. F electrostatic in this case is equal to QE. So they are always parallel or anti-parallel. They are all in the same direction all the time. If Q is positive, they are parallel. If Q is negative, they are anti-parallel. So they are in the same direction all the time. And that is the case of the electrostatics. This question is intended to do something else actually for the calc-based for other things. That is as far as you should be able to really care for in this context, because there is no need to go any further than that. Those are all of the questions. Any question for you guys, for me? Did I miss anything? Do you want to look at the lab report and see, make sure that we have it all filled correctly? I changed the lab due date on it. Did you guys notice that? I think it was this Thursday or today or something. I may change it toward the weekend, so give you more time to basically compile these things and put them together. Yes. Okay. I extend it to the weekend. So let me go through the lab report quickly if there is anything that we need to go through. I don't have it probably open. Oh, no. Yeah. The lab 7, yes, is due tonight. The one that you guys did not turn in because of that disruption and the plans and all of that. So you need to turn in that one, please, okay? So whatever you have, if you didn't finish it, you need to better get a grade than no grade at all. Isn't lab 7 available through upload? I think it is. I think there are some people who uploaded it already. Through a file, basically, yes. That's right. Yeah, you can scan it through the phone, or I think this is, yeah. Okay. Doesn't have to be PDF. An image would do. So if you were able to scan it as with your phone, just basically submit it as is. Okay. So there is a lab that is due tonight. Let me open that file if I can find where it is. Yes. Okay. So this is the lab report. Make sure everything that is read, if you're going to use this file, I know that some of you already have probably started working on this one. I think I know at least. Yes. The goals, again, look, what you're saying, the question from Martin is basically, and I know, guys, you're looking at also the chat session so that you know what the question is. But let me try to put it in, so if I understand it at least, on do we still put the goals and the results? Absolutely. Although the because what you're putting in there is based on the new situation. Some of it based on the pictures. So the results in here are based on the pictures, based on simulation of the GeoGebra. And if you cannot, basically, in terms of results, if you cannot find an access to anything, just state it, okay? But based on the also the lectures, do you have already have your notes based on the textbooks and based on the sources that I just gave you in terms of the Wikipedia or any other source that you guys find in there? But please be specific. Once you put something in there, when you're referring to something, put the link to it, okay? So that we have an understanding of that. We need to keep it as much as possible close from the actual lab and do that basically. So don't leave anything blank. As a matter of fact, there are some fields that are required in here in this lab report if you're going to use the lab report in here. Your name is required. That's why you see the blue, the red zone in there. Your, what is it? The opening paragraph, the objective overall. The magnetic field in here, again, the objective is to basically draw the direction of the magnetic field for different configuration of different magnets. The answers to the questions we did that. The answer to this question, we have it already. The answer to that one we did. The result in here, again, you're trying to compile that. The magnetic field lines leave the North Pole to the South Pole. Okay? You don't need partners. So again, unless you need one because for some reason things are not working for you or you're having problems with your configuration or something, please ask me to put you with somebody else. If you have somebody to work with, tell me we want to work with this person. And I would be more than happy to create a private group for you guys to work together. The reason why I do that is twofold. First of all, we need to keep track of your work together on online, on Canvas. And second, when I'm grading, I don't want to be surprised to see some similar verbiage or similar stuff. Then I would say, okay, you guys were working together and let me know. So I need to really have that so that you don't get penalized. So if you have a person you like to work with, remotely, do not go and meet somewhere and start working this thing together because now everybody has to stay home to keep this thing under control so that we are all safe at the end of the day. That's more important than anything else. You can work together remotely and we'll put it on that together. You don't need a lab partner, okay? You can work by yourself, but if you do choose a lab partner, it's still actually encouraged, please do so. Ask me. And I will put the group for you guys. Okay? So that's the two questions from, at least from Glazel. Okay? Again, the goals for different sections, we already talked about them. Hopefully, you put them together. Okay? And questions 5, 6, 7, we answer all of them. 8, and then the results for that section and the closing paragraph, and you're done with the lab. So this is should be an easy enough lab for you guys. Any general questions for me in terms of this lab or any other labs? This lab 8, what lab is this one that we were talking about? I lost track of the number now. Yeah, lab 8. Okay, at least we need to get minimum of 2 more. Okay, and we will find a way. We'll manage, okay? We'll find a way of doing this. We'll get somehow in there, okay? The lab sessions are always going to be here on time. And the password should be working all the time. And if I do notice that there is a problem with the sessions and things like that, I will be we will be changing things and I will let you know, okay? We have, I think, what, 3 people who are not with us today for one reason or the other. Probably they didn't get the password or things don't work for them. But Everything else is fine. Are you doing also your class live, or you're just doing the recording from the class, from the lecture? Okay, well, it's fine. I mean, I hope you guys have, I'll be more than happy to answer any questions that you guys have, okay? And when is your next exam? Or is it on campus? Okay, this part of the recording will be removed, so you guys don't feel any pressure at the end. So, I mean, I will remove it from the, actually, let me stop it right now.